socially appropriate. And these codes are learned in childhood. When we as children see our adults modeling gender appropriate behavior, we imbibe such behavior. We see that such behavior is acceptable. We see that to be socially acceptable. This behavior must be imbibed, assimilated, and perpetuated. And therefore, we adopt a particular role, we behave in a particular way, and we construct a gender identity. Since we construct a gender identity, this dictates each and every action. This confirms or violates a particular decision, and this colors our behavior. So therefore, the study of gender can be applied to any social context and every literary work. Anything that is concerned with human beings and their existence is concerned with human behavior. And human behavior is in turn subconsisting of gender roles. I hope so far I am more or less audible, more or less clear. Saket, will you confirm? Did they get it so far?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Is the voice clear? Is the PPS clear?
Yes, ma'am. PPT is clear. If you can press F5 and go full screen, ma'am, in the PPT.
Okay. I'll just start the. Is this good?
Yes, ma'am.
Now better?
Yes, ma'am. Done, ma'am.
So, Saket, can everybody see this? Can you read this? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. It is visible.
It is visible and the voice is clear because I am not seeing myself on the screen. I'm only seeing the PPT.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You are visible.
Okay. Now we talk about approaches to gender in literature. When we read a text, what are the elements in a text which are powerful, active? What are the elements in a text which are passive? Which are the characters who are mainstream? Which are the characters who are marginalized? What kind of textual support do they get? Are they presented through a traditional narrative, a linear narrative? Are they presented through a third-person narrative? Whose point of view is superior? Whose point of view is inferior? Who is the focus? Who is not the focus? What kind of language is given to a particular character? What kind of rhetoric is given to another character? And when we look at this work of literature or this work of history or this work of cultural studies, how does it contribute to our knowledge of gender and its roles in society and literature? To understand this, we need to understand a few seminal theories, and that is why I have made this PowerPoint, because I want the students and the younger scholars to understand exactly who or what are the seminal theorists and what exactly do they have to say. Now, you are all very capable students, and of course, we also have a galaxy of teachers and professors in the audience. So I will not insult you by reading out my PowerPoint. I will leave it up to you to read the PowerPoint. I will simply make a few humble suggestions and explanations. These are the leading or the basic women's studies theorists that we discuss when we talk about gender. What do they have to say? Now, among these theorists, when we talk about Mary Wollstonecraft, who wrote A Vindication of the Rights of Women, she rejects the view of weakness. If you remember, women are usually called the weaker sex or the inferior sex, or even very euphemistically, the fairer sex. She rejects the view of women being naturally and intrinsically weaker and therefore inferior to men. She says that the relationships are unequal because the woman is not given her due place. Alongside the man, the woman performs a very important role in society, and that is the role of social propagation. She bears a child and she nurtures a child, and the child later becomes a very important member of society. So this inequality between men and women is due to education. And to be treated as equals, because they perform a very pivotal and a very vital role, even if that is the bringing up of children, women require an education, and it is imperative that women be educated. Until they are educated, they will remain in a secondary and inferior position, and their role in society will be sidelined. So she has a suggestion that instead of becoming wives only, women must become companions. And she was one of the first thinkers to propose that gender roles are not natural. They are social. She says that the woman has been culturally conditioned and trained to believe that she must follow certain codes of behavior. She must acquire certain traits which make her feminine. So the female and the feminine are two different things. Being female is biological. Being feminine is socio-cultural, because there are certain values which are given by society, rather by patriarchy, so that she can acquire these values and fit into the category of the feminine. Please remember, the category of the feminine. And this is when you remember Kamala Das, when she says, be cook, be embroiderer, be quarreler with servants, fit in, they cried. This is what she is referring to, this categorization of the female into the feminine. Please be very clear. Female is biology and feminine is the socio-cultural category created for the woman to keep her secondary, to keep her inferior, and to keep her marginalized. Now we come to the 20th century theorist, Virginia Woolf, who has these books. You know them very well. You are scholars. A Room of One's Own and Three Guineas. She says that we must have a woman-centric activism in reading and education. We are living with patriarchal education systems where the canon is created from the masculine point of view, male-authored narratives or male-focused narratives are given predominance. We are trained to read from the male point of view. So the reader response is conditioned to accept the male point of view as the absolute point of view. And this is inaccurate when it comes to women reading. So she says that women are not reading as women. They are trained to read from the male point of view. Aesthetics, values, literary traditions, mores, stylistic devices, nuances and themes adopted by the male literary authors and critics within the patriarchal setup are transmitted to women and are generated and promoted as universal, although they do ignore the experiences of women and marginalized communities. She says that writing in itself is gendered. The language available to the woman is not her own language. It is the language of the male writers before her. It is the established conventional language that has been in practice for so many centuries, and she is forced to use this sexist language despite the fact that it does not truly capture her experience. Whether it is diction, realism, linearity, order, all the literary modes and stylistic nuances that we call normative aesthetics are traditionally male-centered. Any woman who writes violating these normative aesthetics is usually dismissed. So for a woman author, to be accepted, she must use the same attributes in her writing that she is using in her experience. This is what Virginia Woolf writes, and this is what she is very, very firm in her articulation about. Now we come to the seminal work by Simone de Beauvoir, which is The Second Sex. This was translated into English in 1984. And she says that there is a stereotype, and women are conditioned to accept this stereotype voluntarily. They accept that, yes, this is the behavior, these are the beliefs, and these are the practices that women must ideally follow. And their acceptance, voluntary acceptance of this, their perpetuation of this to others of succeeding generations is what empowers patriarchy. So as she says, one is not born a woman, one becomes one. So a woman is not born, she is made. She is a construct that has been created by the oppressive systems of patriarchy. So sex is biological and gender is social. This is what Simone de Beauvoir says. She says that women have always been regarded as the negative of men, and men have always been regarded as the ideal and the norm. The woman is the deviant or the other. She seeks to become perfect by conforming to the vision of the existence established by the ideal. If man is the ideal, he is establishing a vision, and a woman who is conforming to this vision is perfect. So Simone de Beauvoir talks about the process of othering self and other. The man is the center, the woman is the margin. The man is the self and the woman is the other. She is his opposite. She is his inferior. He is the primary subject, the higher being. And she is the lower subject, the inferior being. And therefore, in patriarchal culture, the man and the woman exist as the subject and the other, or an opposition, or a binary. So this creation of the woman, this making of the woman at the hands of patriarchy, is what makes her a product of patriarchal culture. It is what makes her a social category. And Beauvoir was one of the first theorists to turn gender into a social category. Now we come to Judith Butler. Judith Butler went one step ahead and she said that gender is a performance. Since we undertake gender roles, gender becomes a performance enacted by individual. Because by virtue of being a role, by virtue of being a culmination of actions, gender becomes a performance. It is not inborn. It is not innate. It is not intrinsic. An individual can change his performance in the way he talks, he walks, the clothes he wears, how he speaks to authority, how he speaks to figures who are superior, how he or she accepts and rebels against the culture and society. So this act of choosing to perform a role is definitely social, but this role can change, it can alter, it can come in conflict with the fixed category. It may have its meaning governed by location, time, and culture. So gender is a continuous performance whose meaning can never be fixed or universal. this performance is the repeated citation or the iteration of a role in a particular context. With each iteration, the role may change, and gender in its meaning can thus be constructed through repeated performances of behaving like a woman or like a man. So she says that identity is performatively constituted by expressions that are its results. How you express yourself becomes the way in which you manifest your identity in society, in a particular time, and in a particular situation. Now we come to Elaine Showalter. Elaine Showalter, most of you must be knowing this, she coined a new term called gynocriticism. This talks about the woman author as a creator of meaning. And you have the definition of gynocriticism given here, which talks about women as writers, writing from their own female experience, using their female creativity and the laws of a female literary tradition. This kind of a literary tradition is the opposite of male critical theory, because this talks about women creating their own code of aesthetics. In this code of aesthetics, what becomes very important is race, ethnicity, class, geography, sexuality, and socio-cultural reality. So these are all then included as analytical categories within the ambit of gender and culture. When we come to the advent of post-structuralism, we have numerous writers, theorists, post-structuralist theorists, Helen Csikszentmihalyi, Julia Kristeva, Luz Irigaray. They talk about ekritior feminine, or women's writing. And some of the things that they say about women's writing is that it subverts the tradition of male-centric normative aesthetics. It uses a new language. It uses a new style, new kinds of symbolism and imagery, very sexualized, very physical. And all the notions of language, form, narrative, order, organization are either inverted or subverted. One of the main points of ekritior feminine or women's writing is that it is subjective. It is very, very personal. It talks about their own body, their own life, their own society, their own practices, what they face and how they survive. Since it is experimental and mostly confessional writing, it experiments with syntax, with typography, with blanks, with language, with coinages of new words, and even with experiments of style and language and the usage of coinage of indigenous language phrases in between the traditional English phrases or phraseology. Of course, an example that I can give you is once again something that is very, very known to everybody, and that is Kamala Das, when she says that I am not just writing about myself, I am writing about all of us. I am the sinner, I am the saint, I am the beloved and the betrayed. There is no one but I who call myself I. I commit various misdeeds. I commit various deeds because I am trying to assert my identity. So these are some of the most immortal lines in women's writing in India, because an introduction is also autobiographical poetry where she says, I am the sinner, I am the saint, I am the beloved, I am and the betrayed. So this is one of the classic examples of women's writing. Before I come to the ancillary subject of autobiography, I would just like to once again tap Saket and ask Saket. Saket, is everything going good so far? Hello, Saket? Saket, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You are audible, ma'am. And your PPT is also visible.
And everything is very clear?
Yes, ma'am. Clear, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. If there is anything, please feel free to stop me in the middle and then guide me to anything that, any glitch yes, that comes, please make sure that you stop.
Sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
So I am continuing with what I think is very important for the scholars and students of today to know. How did women's studies in India begin? So I'm giving you, within this limited time, a very, very small overview of women's studies in India. Now, the founding point of women's studies goes back to a report published in 1974 called Towards Equality, published by the Committee on the Status of Women in India. This was appointed by the government in 1972 to make a report on the condition of women in India. And this was the time when feminism in India was making a powerful rise. And the Towards Equality report.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, yes? Just a second. You know, your PPT is not visible because someone else is presenting. Shahnoor Fatima? Shahnoor Fatima, please stop presenting. These students may have clicked on their phones. You know, they must have clicked somewhere on their screen.
By mistake, please stop presenting. I'll start again. Yes. I'll start again. I'll see who's presenting and then
In case students, you are unable to see the PowerPoint presentation, please click on the People tab in the right-hand corner. There, you know, please find ma'am's icon, Shabina Omar presentation, and click on that. And pin that presentation to your screen. Okay, it will be visible. Please type in your chat boxes whether the presentation is visible to you. Yes. Yes, ma'am, you can present.
I'll start presenting again. It's very good that it happened right now because these glitches take place on Google, you know, they happen. Just give me a minute. I'll get back to my presentation.
Yes, students, if it is not visible any time in between,
click on the people tab,
find out presentation, Shabina Omar, click on that icon, pin that to your screen, it will be visible.
Just a minute, I am presenting. Now, can you see the PPT?
Yes, ma'am. Please type yes in your chat boxes, students.
They've typed.
Yes,
it is visible.
Okay. Yes. So I'm starting with an overview of women's studies in India. As you can read in the PowerPoint, the report Towards Equality is the founding point of the establishment of women's studies in India. And this report was published in 1974 by the Committee on the Status of Women in India. And this was the time when the feminist movement in India was witnessing a powerful rise. So the Towards Equality report emphasized the increasingly distressing condition of women in the spheres of health, employment, social status, and political participation. These findings prompted the ICSSR to fund research projects in universities. In 1974, the SNDT Women's University Bombay set up a unit for research, which became a center in 1985. And this was the beginning of the feminist intervention in Indian academia. The objective was to create domains where knowledge is self-reflexively produced. Please note that the term feminism was not used mainly because of its association with the movement in the West, because it had very hostile identifications then. So the feminist... Yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt you again. Your PPT, you know, the window has to be minimized a little. The students are unable to see the full PPT.
I did minimize my window. Saket yes. told me that he wanted the full PPT to be running. So I clicked on this slideshow.
It was visible at that moment, ma'am.
Now it's okay, Saket, right?
Yes, now it's okay, ma'am. You can continue, ma'am.
So this is, I can continue like this. This is good for you?
Yes. Yes,
ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
You can see the full PPT, are you sure?
It's fully visible. Fully visible. The full PPT is visible now.
Right. So I'm continuing. Just give me a second. So the feminist ideology made itself visible in the women's study perspective, with scholars arguing that this was a big step in moving away from the mainstream point of view or the male point of view. Now, this process of institutionalization was made and facilitated by initiatives like the National Conference on Women's Studies in 1981, and the idea of forming the IAWS came into being. This became a platform for the scholars and academicians to share their work, journals. Other institutions came to be involved. In fact, publishing houses began to facilitate the growth of the field. The University Grants Commission was also instrumental in institutionalizing women's studies as an interdisciplinary discipline in higher education. And a seminar was organized by the IAWS in 1985 on the importance of funding women's studies centers that would be dependent and at par with other departments and faculties. So in 1986, when the UGC brought out the guidelines for the development of women's studies in Indian universities and colleges, we had, along with universities, non-academic spaces like research centers, autonomous research centers established in the 1980s, Institute of Social Sciences Trust, Center for Women's Development Studies, and the Institute of Social Science Trust in Delhi being one of the earliest ones. What was the aim of these research committees? What was the aim of these research centers? They wanted to generate new data and analysis on various aspects relating to women, adding new knowledge and adding a critical perspective to social science academia. So in 1979, a group of women studies scholars held a meeting defining the objectives of women studies as a transformation of spheres for knowledge production through research, for changing the perspectives of contribution of women in society, as well as the focus on women-centric issues in the constantly transforming Indian society. So we understand that women's studies began to encourage an overall transformation of the academic community to address issues that concerned the lives and experiences of women. Am I clear so far? Saket? Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So
yes, ma'am.
Somebody's yes, mic yes. is on, Saket. Something is disturbing my audio. I can hear some sounds in the background. So somebody's mic is on, I think. Will you please ask if anybody's mic is on?
No, ma'am. Now no mic, sir.
All clear? No, because I could hear children and shouting in the background. So I thought maybe by mistake somebody's mic is on. Now
all
I
clear, ma'am.
All clear. So far, all clear. But there was a lot of static and sounds coming in. Now I come to my next point, the book Women's Studies in India, by Neera Desai, in which she tells you the objective of women's studies programs. And that objective is given here very clearly. And what is the conception of the women's studies program? And from her quotes and her books, we understand that scholars of women's studies had two tasks. Number one, they had to create social awareness and engage in activism. And number two, they had to create and develop a multidisciplinary knowledge system capable of understanding, explaining, and theorizing the experiences of women in different locations. So with this clear, I have explained what is gender and sex. I have explained what are gender roles and gender identity. I have explained what are the leading feminist theorists. I have explained the difference between the female and the feminine. I have also given everybody an overview, a very, very brief overview about the advent and development of women's studies in India. Now I come to autobiography. What is autobiography? One would say it is self-writing. So let us look at the patriarchal and traditional theories and the contemporary and feminist theory. One of the theories of autobiography is the seminal work by James Olney in Metaphors of the Self. He calls it a monument of the self. It's something that becomes a metaphor of the self in a summary moment of composition. When Olney talks about autobiography, as you can see from reading the PowerPoint, his focus is male-oriented narrative, masculine experience, and the discussion of how the known must stand for the unknown and fit into an organized pattern of knowledge. He has taken some of his ideas from George Gusdorf. George Gusdorf had advocated the autobiography as an individualizing paradigm. Or even better, when he's quoted, he says it is the centrally located, isolate autobiographical set. Women and marginal entities do not have an isolate autobiographical set. So Olney and Gusdorf are essentially sidelining, ignoring, and overlooking groups like women, colored people, people of different race, ethnicity, and sexuality. Because these are people who they regard as unfit to be autobiographical subjects, since they do not have what we know as the isolate autobiographical self. Now we come to the feminist theorists. We have Susan Stanford Friedman, when she says that self-creation and self-consciousness are very different. Your self-consciousness might be very different from Kamala Das's self-consciousness. My self-consciousness might be very, very different from Toru Dutt's self-consciousness. What Sylvia Plath is writing may be very, very different from what Kamala Das is writing. Or they may be similar, but the consciousness may be different. So all autobiographical writing cannot be about the unique self or the central isolate self. Even in individualizations, there are differences. And when you are writing an autobiography, it must reflect your living identity, your sociocultural reality, and this cannot be measured by one yardstick for all. So when we come to the feminist theories of the 90s, we have people like Estelle Jelinek, Shari Benstock, Sheila Robotham, Nancy Schodorow, Susan Friedman, and Mazur. They expose the inapplicability of this patriarchal exclusionist theory of autobiography to women. They say that women writing, women self-writing, women autobiography must require and must develop a very different kind of poetics for itself. Because we must understand that autobiography as a literary genre has always been a contested category in India. We are very happy that it's an interpretation of life, but giving it the value of a literary text has not been adequate. So with women's studies coming onto the scene, the development of women's writing also came to the forefront. And when this women's writing came to the forefront, it showed its force in one of the genres, many genres, but one of the genres was the autobiography. And why? Because autobiography has a double narrative. It is the author and the self. And women were showing the problems of their own lives and society. Because it was a process of exploring the self in a way of creating the self. So you are creating a self in the very act of exploring or seeking yourself. We have a very powerful South Asian voice, Chandra Talpade Mohanty, who writes that we are living in a world with powerful histories of resistance and revolution in daily life. And because we are experiencing resistance and revolution in daily life, these are issues which pose questions and challenges for a feminist historiography, for a feminist epistemology, and for a feminist academia. We should develop our own ways of reading, analyzing, and including these into the mainstream, because they are reconceptualizations of the ideas of resistance, community, and agency in daily life. So when we are looking upon autobiography in India with reference to Dalit literature, and I shall give you a very brief overview, because in the span of time, one cannot go into great detail, but I shall definitely give you an overview in such a way that you can explore it at length if you want. Dalit literature in general and autobiography in particular shows you several things. One, what is the condition of the society and how the individuals of that society are oppressed by their own communities, by the larger society, and by a general greater society. Number two, how in a modern urbanized setting they want to escape by getting education. Access to school and education is their way towards employment. And once they are able to achieve social mobility in an urban world, they can escape the grip of their repressive and traditional systems. So when we come to Dalit autobiography by women, we must understand that they do not write in isolation. What do they write? They write about the individual and the entire background, historical background, social background, family background, and daily experiences. The individual is not a unique, isolate self. The individual is one person mired in circumstances. And it is against these circumstances. It is from these problems and oppressions that he or she carves out their own identity. So the subject matter is not the unique, isolated self. Rather, it is the struggles, the quests, the conflicts, all the circumstances one has to brave before one becomes successful or victorious. So there is a very big difference between the early and the later biography. Early women autobiographies in Dalit literature are narratives where if they overcome their basic problems and enter the mainstream, they are successful. But the later Dalit autobiographies show a continuous angst, caste stigma, gender discrimination, and women being the doubly marginalized. Marginalized in the society, marginalized at home. Tortured for being a Dalit and oppressed for being a woman. So the worst sufferer is the woman. And thus the focus of later Dalit women's autobiography is the, should we say, coalescence of the I and the we. The individual merges into the community merges into the individual, and there is no separate existence of either. Because it is with this sense of merging that the woman writes her autobiography in Dalit literature. Since it's nearly 1 o'clock, I will conclude that the woman who writes in the subcontinent is actually committing a very daring act. She is appropriating a traditional male bastion. You must be remembering all these older history of literature classes where you had George Eliot writing under a man's name, you had Charlotte Bronte writing under a man's name, because male writing was their territory. And the woman who writes is appropriating a male gesture, but whereas a man describes life, a woman is transcribing life. Please understand that description of life and transcription of life are two different things. By transcribing her life, a woman writer, especially a woman autobiographical writer, is actually expressing herself. She is articulating a culturally silenced voice. Because the feminine has always operated on the periphery of the masculine. The masculine has been the center. The woman has been the periphery. Now she has come to share the center. And this sharing of the center is what is making her speak. And in speaking, in writing, she is breaking her cultural silence. So a woman's writing is always feminine, says Virginia Woolf. But what do you mean by feminine? Feminine does not mean weak. Feminine does not mean inferior. Feminine does not mean lower in standards. Feminine does not mean opposite to man. Feminine means complementary to man, standing shoulder to shoulder with man. Just as the man writes about his experiences, the woman has a right to express her own experiences. Feminine means a balance. Feminine does not mean an opposite or an othering. So therefore, by being a woman autobiographical writer in the Dalit literature of India, we understand that we have a narrative voice which is a double layered voice. The I within the narration, I, myself, me, can have multiple identities. It can talk about yourself in the house. It can talk about I, myself, in the social world. It can talk about I myself as a victim of politics, as a victim of discrimination, as a victim of gender abuse and domestic violence. So the home and the world can merge, can be separate, can overlap each other. The socio-cultural, socio-economic, and socio-political realities can also be expressed by this I myself. So the quality of the I in autobiography, in ekritior feminine, within feminist theory is very, very important. I will give you a small example from a non-autobiographical text. Many of you may have studied Mahesh Dattan. Many of you may have studied in English, Bravely Fought the Queen. It is a drama by Mahesh Dattan. The title of the drama is taken from a Hindi poem by Subhadra Kumari Chauhan. It is called Jhansi Ki Rani. Singhasan hil uthe rajvansho ne bhrikuti tani thi. बूढ़े भारत पे भी आई फिर से नई जवानी थी। चमक उठी संसद कावन में वो तलवार पुरानी थी। खूब लड़ी मर्दानी वो जो झांसी वाली रानी। This line, खूब लड़ी मर्दानी वो जो झांसी वाली रानी, has been transformed and translated into the title of Bravely Fought the Queen. But he has omitted the word mardani. He has not written Bravely Fought the Manly Queen. No, the title is Bravely Fought the Queen. Why? Because mardani or masculinity is not a category for courage. Sahas or bravery can be masculine, it can be feminine. Bravery can be of various types. Bravery does not always mean mardani. A woman can also be. And a man can also be. So therefore, a woman's writing is feminine. But what do you mean by feminine? Do we mean brave? Do we mean path-breaking? Do we mean balanced? Do we mean subjective? We have to understand that there is no superior and no inferior. There is a balance between two sexes, man and woman, who are given gender roles which they condition themselves to accept, and on the basis of that, they write and they express. But now with feminist theory upsurging, we have a woman's writing emerging, and this can be seen in many kinds of poetry, prose, drama, and especially autobiography, of which I have shown you a very small and simple sample, Dalit Women's Autobiography, where the I is not just me in the house. It can be me in my house, me in my caste, me in my society, me in various roles and at various levels, because me, I am the doubly oppressed, the doubly marginalized at home and in the world outside. So the narrative structure of autobiography is full of the multiple I, and women's writing is all about discovering the multiple layers of I, the self, where I can also stand for identity. Having said this, I finish my lecture and I welcome your questions. And these are a few books you can read. These are a few resources which you can access. Some chapters may be available as PDF. And when you reopen after the lockdown, all of us go to work, you can also try and check this out. This will help you for your reference and for your study. And it has been a very, very enriching afternoon. I have tried my best to finish on time. So, colleagues, scholars, students, teachers, all the members of Karim City College, thank you. Adab, Namaskar.
Thank you so much, ma'am. With your permission, if we can take some of the questions.
Please, I would love the questions, Saket. Please take the questions. I've tried to access as many things and include as many things as I could. First of all, I would definitely request Professor S.M. Yahya Ibrahim Sahab for your feedback, sir.
Hello. It was very nice. It was very organized. And for me, it was very interesting because you have included Dalit literature part also in your lecture. That was very fine for me. And I have one question, actually. It's a very simple question. That how do you see the two very famous biographies from India, the one by Gandhi and the one by Neeraj C. Chaudhary, fit into this lecture, fit into this theme of your lecture, that is gender, autobiography, patriarchal biasness? How you see those two biographies? I mean, Gandhi's biography and Neeraj C. Chaudhary's autobiography of an unknown Indian.
Sir, I see them as canonical autobiographies, male-centric narratives, and canonical autobiographies that work with normative aesthetics. We learn a lot from these autobiographies. They are extremely valuable, but they do definitely lack a feminine sensibility.
Yes, that is there.
And sir, they show us how the canon was established, because initially the canon was established with male-centric narratives. So they show us the very salient features of the canon of the autobiography.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Such a pertinent question.
It was a very good lecture. We enjoyed. And we wish that we will see you here in Jamshedpur very soon.
Inshallah, definitely. Looking forward to. Saket, can I take questions?
Yes, ma'am. I can see some questions in chat box, ma'am.
You want me to call them out and give them an answer like that? Should I do that?
Ma'am, I'm calling the name, and if they can unmute their mic and ask you the questions. I can see Dr. Pratibha Kumar. Dr. Pratibha Kumar asking a question. If you can please unmute yourself and ask your question. Dr. Pratibha Kumar. Dr. Pratibha Kumar, are we audible? If you can unmute and ask your question.
Saket, she's saying in the message box she's unable to unmute.
So I'll just read out her questions. Okay, let me take it one by one, Saket. Let me see what I'm getting. I have got some questions on my screen. So let me just see what I have got. I have a question from Niharika Sahu, who says that not only men, but women also are a barrier for other women's success. Niharika Sahu ji, barrier to success is always human. As I told you, we are born men and women, but we assume gender roles. So when we become a barrier for success, it is not depending on our sex or our gender, it depends on our mentality. Some men can't see other people progressing. Some women can't see other people progressing. It's all a question of human mentality. Now, coming to Dr. Pratibha Kumar, she has given me a note of appreciation and said that she had been invited to deliver a lecture in New York. I would love to access that on YouTube. Congratulations, Dr. Kumar. Do I feel still that women are marginalized? Yes, I feel still women are marginalized. Look at the number of cases of domestic violence in this lockdown. These are not uneducated women. These are educated working women in educated families. They are being cast aside. They are not being given a chance to speak. Look at the domestic laborers and staff who come to work for us. Look at the condition of those women in their houses. Women are marginalized in every level of the society, but I believe that with equal support of men, because standing up for a woman does not mean standing up against the men. With equal support of willing men and with solidarity of one woman to another, this marginalization can end, because to some extent, women themselves are also responsible for their marginalization. We have Jashama Afroz on asking me, what is Judith Butler saying that gender is a performance? Miss Afroz, please read Judith Butler.
Yes,
I have left
you,
my
ma'am.
Email.
Thank you, ma'am.
There you are. Is that clear? Is this Niharika ji? Miss Afroz, please read what Judith Butler has written. Please read the text of Judith Butler's book, and then we shall discuss it, because my email is there in the PowerPoint itself. Please get in touch with me with your questions after you have read Judith Butler. These are the questions that I can see as of now. There are others. I'm just reading them. Please give me a minute. I have Shehbaz Ijaz, who says that in your lecture, you have defined the difference between describing and transcribing. Women talk about toxic masculinity, and he has also mentioned the effeminate or the androgynous being apologetic. So what is the demarcation between toxic masculinity and masculinity itself? Sir, masculinity is a set of traits, just as femininity is a set of traits. Now, when it becomes harmful or offensive, when it becomes a conflicting opposition, it becomes toxic. Because as I'm once again saying, standing with a particular sex does not mean standing against a particular sex. Being pro-woman, being feminist, does not mean being anti-man. So the moment you become anti, you become harmful, you become toxic. That, in a sense, is the difference between masculinity and toxic masculinity, explained in very layman's terms without going into theory. Mr. Vinay Anand, ma'am, do you agree that marriage is an outdated patriarchal tradition which is all about perpetuating male privilege? Why are feminists so ignorant and passive about rejecting and reforming the dynamics of marriage, especially in India? Marriage, I would not say, is an outdated patriarchal tradition. Marriage is an institution. And why are feminists so passive and ignorant? It depends on which group of feminists, which category of feminists, and which philosophy of feminism you are referring to. So I think your question needs a little more reflection as to which aspect of marriage and which aspect of feminism you wish to relate, and then maybe a discussion can come in. I do not see any more questions. If there are any students who want to ask their questions, I will be very happy.
Shehbaz wants to unmute and ask a question, ma'am.
Absolutely. Please tell him to go ahead.
Yes, Shehbaz.
Assalamu alaikum, ma'am.
Walaikum assalam.
First and foremost, I'm very thankful for you that you contemplated my question and.
Oh, I'm reading them slowly, one by one. It's not coming on my screen. So, whoever's I can see, I'll
introduce yourself, Shehbaz.
Yes, I can see. Hello?
Shehbaz, introduce yourself to ma'am.
I can hear you, Shehbaz ji. Please carry on.
Ma'am, myself, Shehbaz Ijaz, student of Karim City College, Department of English, SEM 5th.
Thank you so much for having the patience to sit through this lecture.
And I would also like to thank you on the fact that you mentioned the domestic violence increase during this lockdown instance. Mm-hmm. For example, there was an incident in MP where a man just broke the spine of her wife just because he lost in
Ludo
match, the most played game during this lockdown period.
Yes, I know. He broke her spine because he lost in Ludo, but she did not complain against him.
And surely that's not what should be done. And patriarchy Absolutely. Is a phenomenon. And And surely that was not the way our Prophet taught us to live a life with total family
structure. No, but then the problem is, you know, if we follow religion, there is no religion that perpetuates patriarchy. Every religion has given its men and its women a set of rules to live by. It is only when we do not follow religion and religious teachings very objectively, it is only when we misuse religion as a tool of oppression over one particular sex or creed, then the problems in existence occur. So, Shehbaz ji, do you have a question?
No, ma'am. I just wanted to express my gratitude. That's why I unmuted.
I'm so grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'm very grateful for the feedback. Yes. Yes,
ma'am, I have now come to know how to mute and unmute this.
Oh, wonderful.
I would like to congratulate you, ma'am, at the outset that your lecture was very, very clear. It was very distinct. And the way you took up the history and the advent of women writings was absolutely clear.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Pratibha Kumar from Jabalpur, Government Mahakaushal Arts and Commerce College, ma'am. Thank you.
I have been, where did you say you're from?
Pardon, ma'am?
Where did you say you are from, Pratibha ji?
I am from Jabalpur, ma'am.
I have spoken about thrice or four times in Jabalpur at the Rani Durgavati Vishwavidyalaya for the human resource development.
Wow. So anytime you come next. Yes, ma'am.
I know the professor of English in one of the colleges, Alok Chand Soria ji.
Oh, he was the chairman board of studies and a very good friend of ours. Okay.
I know Mahima Tripathi ji very well.
Okay, ma'am. I do know her also.
Thank you. It's wonderful. It's great to connect. All the best to you. And do send me the link for your lecture.
Again, ma'am, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Ma'am, we also have the question from... In the chat box, I can see Agrima Mishra asking a question.
I'll just see, because I was unable to read it then. Abhi padh rahi hu, dekh rahi hu. I have... Agrima. I have Professor Yahya Ibrahim writing about somebody asking me a question between feminism and womanism. Now, feminism is an approach. Womanism, sir, is a construct. It is what a woman should be like. As Shari Benstock says, woman is a category. So an accepted, should I say, code of conduct is womanism, and feminism is a female-oriented approach to life, philosophy, to culture, society. That's the easiest I can discriminate right now without theoretical backup. Anyone else, Saket? Agrima, yes, I've got it here. Ma'am, how do you feel about women's autobiography or women's movement in the age of technology? What is the intersection of Indian feminism with technology? That is what I have as Agrima Mishraji's question. Agrima ji, technology is very important. I feel that intersection of feminism and technology is very positive because it has increased what I call the sisterhood of solidarity or the solidarity of sisterhood. Through technology, we are able to connect. Technology has enhanced feminism. It has increased awareness and opportunity. It has increased connectivity. And in this age of technology, when a woman writes, even if she's writing autobiography, its impact and outreach are greater, its acceptance is greater, its analysis is greater. So whenever the outreach of something is greater, it makes it more open to acceptability and analysis, to identification and even for that matter, conflict. So we can, through technology, appreciate the sameness in the differences and the different areas in our samenesses of experience. That's the easiest way I can put it.
Ma'am, I can see Niharika Sahu also asking a question. If I can read, ma'am.
I've already answered Niharika Sahu.
Okay.
I've already answered Niharika Sahu about the barrier for other women's success. I've answered.
Yes, ma'am. If anyone else want to ask any question.
I have also answered Anuradha Dosarji because I've just explained feminism and womanism. I have answered Jashama Afrozji. I have answered Dr. Pratibha Kumarji, Agrima Mishraji, Shehbaz Ejazji, and I have now a Rifsha Hassan. History bears within to the fact that Dalit literature had emerged in Maharashtra but built on the foundation based on, substantiated by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. It is said to be posing mainstream literature. How did it metamorphose? The question and the language, Rifsha Hassanji, are not very clear, but from what I understand is that how does Dalit literature metamorphose? Dalit literature has metamorphosed with time. With time and with awareness, it has come into mainstream literature as one of the new literatures that we are studying. It is based on the experiences of the Dalits who were not simply oppressed by the higher castes and the powerful in the country, but they were oppressed from within their own society. So they lacked basic facilities, they lacked education, and they also lacked respect that was given to the other. So their protest emerged in writing and it became a literature of protest and of experience. And then it became absorbed and assimilated into society over time, into the mainstream as a literature that is a new force to be reckoned with. And now it has been it has been in the syllabi of many universities and colleges for a very long time. So that's all, Saket. I don't see any more questions.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. I, on behalf of Department of English, Karim City College, extend my most sincere thanks to you, Shabina ma'am, who spared time from her busiest schedule to enlighten us with this talk on gender and autobiography, a feminist perspective. And also big thank you to all the listeners who stayed with us. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this wonderful talk, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Professor Yahya Ibrahim, thank you, Saket, thank you, Boshudhara. It has been a pleasure and a privilege, and a big thank you to all the listeners, students, scholars, colleagues, and friends for your patient attention. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. Bahut shukriya.
Anytime.
Thank you, Shabina ji. It was very enlightening.
Thank you so much. It was so good meeting everybody.
So we can sign off, sir.
Yes, I think we should sign off.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.